Good afternoon, my dear students. I hope you had your lunch by this time. In continuation with today's topic related to the brain, we are continuing with this one of the again important topic that is related to the brain as well. Which is considered to be the white matter of the cerebrum. The white matter of cerebrum can be learned under these headings as slide. So under these, by the time this chapter gets over, so you should be very much familiar about these questions or the certain aspect of the white matter. So that is very much expected from you. Now, like you are supposed to know about how to define the white matter, or in the sense of what exactly the white matter is, and the types of the white matter or the fibers. Whereas the second option or second question, important topic related to this chapter would be something called as the corpus callosum. So as you can make out over here, the corpus callosum. So it has to be learned under these headings as external features, the connections, functional significance of that. Then other than that, equally important would be one more topic, that is the internal capsule. Now, internal capsule can be, like a corpus callosum can be a 5-marker question, whereas internal capsule can be 5-marker as well as a 10-marker, which is equally important. So it has to be learned under these headings as the parts, the connections, the fibers, and the blood supply. And the last but not the least would be the applied aspect related to these topics. So now first we will begin with by defining the white matter. Now white matter, I probably assume that you know the meaning of the white matter. So white matter is nothing but the nerve fibers or the axons of the cell bodies of the neurons, which are collected in the form of a bundle of a group of fibers. So that is how you can define the white matter. So it's considered to be a mass or a bundle of white matter fibers, which is compactly arranged. Compactly arranged in the sense arranged underneath the outer cerebral cortex, which is nothing but the gray matter area. So that is how you define the white matter. So of course it is included with the neuroglia. So neuroglia plus the nerve fibers collectively, which is arranged compactly under the cerebral cortex, is considered to be the white matter. So that is how we define the white matter. Whereas for descriptive purpose, again, the white matter is or white matter can be learnt under these following headings as association or association fibers, commissural fibers, and projection fibers. So this is how, for descriptive purpose, the white matter is divided for better learning. Now, what we will do is we will take up individual types of the fibers, which are categorized into three as association, commissural, and projection. Now, in the diagram to the right side, you can make out a section of the cerebrum, wherein it shows about all the three types of fibers of white matter. So as association fibers are being to the extreme right side, so association fibers, whereas commissural or these fibers are considered to be the commissural fibers, which are like connecting the two aspects or two halves of the cerebral hemisphere. Whereas the third one is the projection fibers, as you can make out on either side. So these are the projection fibers. No doubt they are projecting down from the cerebral cortex to the lower or the subcortical centers or the areas of the brain. So that's why they are called as projectional fibers. Now this is how the white matter is divided into three parts. Now individually we look into these stuff again, the same magnified view of the diagram showing the association fibers, the commissural fibers, and the projection fibers on either side. Now now we'll see in detail about how exactly these certain details related to the individual types of fibers. Now if you take up the first one, first group under the white matter of the cerebrum, it would be the association fibers. As the name itself suggests, association. So association in the sense it will associate the adjoining parts in the same hemisphere, or it will be more specifically, it will be connecting, or it is like an interconnection between the different regions of the different regions of the cerebral cortex in the same hemisphere though. So that is how we can define the association fibers. They are present in the same hemisphere, and in the same hemisphere they connect the different regions in the same hemisphere. So that will be the like a more precise way to describe the association fibers. Now again, so that is how we can use one more term over here for the association fiber as intrahemispheric. So in the sense which are situated inside the, or which are more specifically said to be in the same hemisphere. So that suggests the intrahemispheric fibers. Now for again better descriptive purpose, depending upon what they connect and depending upon the length, so they are categorized into two subheadings as a short association fibers and long association fibers. Now what exactly these two are? Now again, as the name itself suggests, now short is a short because of the length of the fiber. So because of the length of the fiber, as you can make out in the diagram on your right side. Now the short association fibers are these. Now they are like, now as you can see, the elevation is considered to be, this elevation is the gyri, and the depression is the sulci. And same way gyri and sulci, as you can make out. So all the depressions are the sulci and the rest of it is the gyri. Now these fibers are the fibers, association fibers are considered to be short association. So since they connect the gyri to the adjoining gyri, and these fibers, they hook around or pass through the sulci, underlying sulci. So that is the reason why. So this being, they are called as short, as I said, because they are like interconnecting the corresponding gyri. So that is the reason why they are considered to be the short association fibers. And the other terminology where they use synonymously with the short association fiber would be arcuate fibers. So this term can also be used in relation to the short association fibers. Now that is the first type of association, that is a short association. Now if you look into the second subdivision of the association fiber was the long association fiber, as the name itself suggests, again being quite longer. And these bundles of fibers that you are seeing over here, they are considered to be the long examples for the long association fibers. So no doubt or no wonder they connect the gyri in the region of the frontal lobe of the cerebral hemisphere to a gyri in the occipital lobe of the cerebral hemisphere. So that is how since they connect the distant regions of the same cerebral hemisphere, So they are considered to be or called as long association fibers. So that is how it has been defined here. So they travel for a longer distance and they interconnect widely separated gyri. So hence they are called as the long association fibers. So that is about the association fibers. Whereas now again, same diagram showing a magnified view. I have used it multiple times so that I can get a better view of the image on the camera. Now if you take up the second group of white matter fiber, that is the commissural fibers. Now commissural fiber, dictionary meaning of the commissure means to say that it connects the different parts or different aspects of a certain region. So that is why they are called as a commissure. Now commissural fiber, if you wish to define the commissural fibers, so they are nothing but they interconnect the identical areas or identical cortical areas, more precisely, of the two cerebral hemispheres, that is from right to left or left to right. So that is how they are called as the commissural fibers. So that's why they can even be called by one more term as the interhemispheric fibers. So since they connect the two cerebral hemispheres on either side, so that's why they are also called as interhemispheric fibers. Now these commissural, just like the association fibers that we saw earlier, now even the commissural fibers are subdivided for better understanding purpose or for better description. So this is how they are the commissural fibers, or categorization of the commissural fibers, are categorized into five types. So as the corpus callosum, anterior and the posterior commissure, hippocampal commissure, and the habenular commissure. So this is how it has been sub-categorized, the commissural fibers. Now out of these, again from examination point of view, equally important would be this one, that is the corpus callosum. Now corpus callosum is considered to be among all the five, the corpus callosum is considered to be the largest commissural fibers among the entire group. Now this is a very standard five marker question. So we look into slightly in detail about this corpus callosum now. I assume that again you might be very much aware where exactly the corpus callosum located, and you might have very much realized the importance of that one as well. As you can make out in the diagram on your right side, so you can make out this darkly colored area. So this dark colored area is considered to be the corpus callosum. This is a medial surface of the cerebrum. So wherein the cerebral hemispheres are cut across the corpus callosum, so that we can visualize the medial aspect of the cerebrum. Now these corpus callosum location wise, if you wish to locate the corpus callosum, so more precisely you can locate it with respect to the border, that is the median longitudinal border. If at all if you are aware of the external features of the cerebrum, one among the border was the median longitudinal border. So just underneath the median longitudinal border, running parallel to that, would be the corpus callosum. So that is now like the bridge or communication that connects the two cerebral hemispheres. Since this being the largest of the commissural fibers, now almost consists of about 100 million fibers are supposed to be present in the corpus callosum. So that is how the importance of the corpus callosum. This will help us in a better exchange of the information between the two cerebral hemispheres. Now next we look into the features, external features about the corpus callosum. Now again, if you wish to describe slightly as an introductory sentences to the corpus callosum, so considered to be white matter fiber, which is roughly resembles alphabet C. So alphabet C, in that way you can say it as a C-shaped white matter fibers which connect the two cerebral hemispheres, present or located on the medial surface of the cerebral hemisphere. So that is how you can define or write an introductory note to the corpus callosum. Whereas now looking into the excuse me. So now looking into the parts of the corpus callosum, it has been categorized, or it has been divided into four parts, like from before backwards. Now this would be the same diagram. So now this is considered the anterior aspect of the cerebral hemisphere. Now the other aspect would be there. This would be the posterior aspect of the cerebral hemisphere. Now if you go from before backwards, keeping that in mind, cerebral the corpus callosum is divided into four parts, as this one being the extension here lower down. This is considered with the rostrum of the corpus callosum. So rostrum of the corpus callosum, then the bent that you are seeing here, the bent, this is called the genu of the corpus callosum, whereas the larger most part would be the body of the corpus callosum, or even you can call it as a trunk or the central part of the corpus callosum. Whereas the posterior most part is considered again quite larger, massive. This is the splenium of the corpus callosum. So that is how the corpus callosum is divided into three parts. Now slight some of the brief points related to each of the individual parts of the corpus callosum. Now if you take up the first part, that is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Now as I pointed out, this is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Now the rostrum is that part of the corpus callosum which almost extends downwards and backwards here. So this is considered to be the rostrum. Now this is the one or like extends from the genu. This is the bent is the genu, extending from the genu downwards and backwards is the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Whereas the now what happens is, now to be more specific, if at all if you wish to describe where it ends, so it is said to be like it ends almost at the level of the upper end of the lamina terminalis. So lamina terminalis is this particular part which has been labeled over here as a lamina terminalis. Now this lamina terminalis, so what exactly the lamina terminalis is? Nothing but a gray matter area, a thin sheet of gray matter area. So lamina terminalis, this is just for your better understanding. So what exactly the lamina terminalis? It is nothing but a thin sheet of gray matter area, so which will regulate, that is more precisely the ionic regulation in the form of sodium and other electrolyte balance or regulation is done or maintained or regulated by the lamina terminalis. So that is about the rostrum of the corpus callosum. Now looking into the second part of the corpus callosum is the genu, which is nothing but the bent of the corpus callosum. That is called the genu, means bent. The meaning of the word genu refers to as a as the bent. Now the genu part, now this part is the one the fibers extending from this particular part or the genu, they will extend on to connect the frontal lobe of the cerebral hemisphere on either side. So they will connect on either side frontal hemispheres or frontal lobes, sorry, frontal lobes of two hemispheres are connected by the fibers passing through the genu. Now that gives a fork-like appearance of the fibers. Now as you can make out in a transverse section through the brain, where you can see from the top, once the brain, the upper part of the brain has been cut and separated, so you can see over here, this region represents the genu of the corpus callosum. Now the fibers that are connecting on either side the frontal lobe of the cerebral hemisphere, so this is considered as they use a term called the forceps minor. So means to say that gives a resemblance or appearance of the forceps like appearance, so that's why as the forceps minor. So considered with respect to the related with respect to the genu of the corpus callosum. Whereas the third part, the trunk or the central part or the body of the corpus callosum, is the more larger part. Rest of it, this part is considered to be the body of the corpus callosum. Now fibers, as you can make out, which has been laid down over here. So the fibers, so they extend on either side. Now they connect the frontal as well as a major part of the frontal and the parietal lobes of the cerebral hemisphere on either side. So that will be that is related to the trunk of the corpus callosum. Whereas the fourth part of the corpus, now again, if you wish to remember, now as you can make out, this is again a sagittal section view. Now here, this is the corpus callosum. What you can make out, the body of the corpus callosum is this part. This is the rostrum, the bent or the genu, body of the corpus callosum. Now underlying this would be, now this this area, that space that you are seeing, your white colored space, is considered to be the central part of the lateral ventricle. Now as you must be aware by this time, the lateral ventricle has a extensions or parts as anterior horn, posterior and inferior horn, and the central part or the body of the lateral ventricle. Now the body of the corpus callosum is it contributes to the roof, or it contributes as a roof to the central part of the lateral ventricle. That is what it means with respect to this sentence. Whereas with respect to the fourth part now, so fourth part of the corpus callosum is the posterior most part. So it is considered to be the splenium of the corpus callosum, again a quite larger part. Now fibers related to this splenium of the corpus callosum, so they will connect the remaining part of the parietal lobe as well as the occipital lobe of the of the cerebral hemispheres. But now if you wish to be more precise with the location of the splenium of the corpus callosum, overhangs. Now it is like overhanging the certain aspects of the brainstem, as the midbrain part of the midbrain, and overhangs even the pineal gland. So that is how just above the spinal and the midbrain, parts of the midbrain will be considered to be the splenium of the corpus callosum. Whereas the fibers, as I said earlier, so it will connect the occipital and even include that, even you can include as a parietal lobe of the cerebral hemisphere on both sides, are connected along with the occipital lobe, are connected by the fibers which are present in the splenial part of the corpus callosum. Now the fibers resemble, again they sweep backwards onto the occipital lobes. Now they resemble again like the extensions of the fork, so that's why like a forceps, so extensions of the forceps, so that's the reason why it is considered to be or called as even as a forceps major. Now with respect to the genu, it was called as the forceps minor. With the same fiber which, when they sweep backwards, connecting the occipital lobe of the cerebral hemispheres on either side, they are considered to be the forceps major. So that is about the parts of the corpus callosum. Whereas a word about something called as the tectum part. Now the basic four basic parts of the corpus callosum are related to the rostrum, the genu, the body, as well as the splenium of the corpus callosum. Whereas a word about something called as this part, which has been labeled over here, is considered to be the tapetum. Now tapetum is nothing but that part of the or the fibers, the bunch or group of fibers that are related to the trunk and the splenium collectively. The remaining part of the trunk, the posterior most part of the trunk, and some of the fibers of the splenium of the corpus callosum, collectively they are considered to be the tapetum. So this is again a word to be remembered with respect to additional in relation to the corpus callosum. Now they are considered to be which are not intersected by fibers of the corona radiata. So what exactly is the corona, which are not intersected by corona radiata, in the sense the fibers, like the descending fibers from the corpus, from the cerebral cortex, when they are descending down through the, as you can make out over here. Now this region is called as, we'll see that in the coming slide, as this region, V-shaped region, is called as the internal capsule. Now the fibers are extending from the cerebral cortex, they run downwards, and they don't intersect or come in contact with these group of fibers that is related to this part, that is as well as the spleen of the corpus callosum. So that is how they use the terminology to describe the tapeworm. Now this image again shows the meaning of this one. When we use this term as the corona radiata, nothing but a bunch or group of fibers when they start from the cerebral cortex, so they converge and pass through the internal capsule. So now these bundle of fibers, they don't intersect the that group of, particularly these group of fibers related to the trunk and the splenium, so which are considered to be the tapetal part of the corpus callosum. So that is about that is how the parts of the corpus callosum can be remembered. Whereas the applied as the functional aspect of the corpus callosum is as since it connects the two cerebral hemispheres on either side, so it helps us in exchange of information for a better way of understanding or learning process. So these interconnections between the cerebral hemisphere is essential, which is brought about equally by the corpus callosum. Whereas the applied aspect related to the corpus callosum would be one particular syndrome here, which is called as the split brain syndrome. So this can cause can vary from being congenital to being a surgical resection or a severed severing at that particular region. So whatever the condition, so congenital absence or surgical sectioning of the corpus callosum leads to isolation of the cerebral hemispheres, so that the patient feels or responds as if he or she has two sets of separate brains. So that is how that aspect can be mentioned with respect to the corpus callosum. So that was about the largest commissural fibers. We are still in the, we had completed the association fibers. Now we have started with the commissural fibers of the white matter of the cerebrum. In that, again, the largest commissural fiber was the corpus callosum. We just finished the corpus callosum. Now we look into the other subdivisions of the commissural fibers, as we had seen earlier, to be the anterior commissure, posterior habenular commissure, all those in slight just in brief about these parts as well. Now, anterior, as the name itself suggests, located more on the anterior aspect of the cerebral hemisphere, on the medial side or medial surface. Now, this again shows the medial surface of the cerebrum. As you can make out, and no doubt the cerebral cortex has been isolated. Now, what you can make out, the corpus callosum. Now, this is the location of the anterior commissure. Anterior commissure is a very, very small set or bundle or bunch or group or tract of fibers that will connect which cross over through the by midline they cross over the midline and connect the two aspects of the cerebral hemisphere. Now, location, as I said, location would be more precisely, you can say it as located with respect to the lamina terminalis again, where especially the upper part of the lamina terminalis. As you can make out over here, this thin sheet of gray matter, as I told you earlier, lamina terminalis is nothing but a thin sheet of thin sheet of gray matter fiber, which acts as an osmoregulator, which is more osmosensitive osmoregulator that maintains the regulates the ionic balance. So that is with respect to the lamina terminalis. Apparent, trace the lamina terminalis apparent, so it ends up into this anterior commissure, where you can make out that. Now, a word again, now we can even describe the anterior commissure in relation to it lies in front of the anterior column of the fornix. What exactly is the fornix? Now, fornix again, this you will come into, get a better idea with respect to the limbic system when we see into the coming classes. There you will get a better idea about what exactly is the fornix. But they say that the fornix is that part of white matter wherein you can come across all the three sets of these white matters, that is be it association or commissural or projection fibers. All the three sets of fibers are seen as in the fornix itself, which is a part of the limbic system. Now, that is how I can even remember the importance of the fornix as well. Now, like now again, as I told you earlier, we have discussed this earlier as what exactly the lamina terminalis is. So we'll not go into that part again. Now, as I said, the fornix is this part. Now, as has been labeled over in the diagram in green color, what you see here, this is the white matter area or the bundle, so which is called the fornix, which is a part of the limbic system. Again, more or less same like as described shape with respect to the alphabet C, as we see shape bundle of fibers, so that they basically carry that. We'll look into that in detail in the limbic system. So that is how the fornix, importance of the fornix in relation to the anterior commission. Now this in turn again has a for better understanding, this is also subdivided into two parts, as the anterior part as a smaller anterior, larger posterior, and the smaller anterior part. Now this larger anterior part, as you can make out again across the horizontal section through the brain, and you are looking the brain from superior aspect. Now this is the anterior aspect of the brain, this is the posterior aspect of the brain. Now keeping that in mind, you can, if you can make out, now this represents the this region represents the anterior commission, now which has been divided into two parts, larger posterior part. So posterior part is the one, the larger posterior part connecting the temporal lobes. Now these are the temporal lobes connecting temporal lobes, where the anterior whereas the small anterior part, this will connect especially the olfactory region of the cerebral hemisphere. So that is how we can describe the subdivision of the anterior commissure, as to be a larger posterior part connecting the temporal lobes, but the smaller anterior part connecting the olfactory region. Now this olfactory region, where exactly the olfactory region, this lies in relation with respect to the limbic system again. So that is where you can make out the olfactory region as well, connected by the small anterior part of the commissural fibers. This is one view of diagram. There is one more view of the diagram you can make out over here as well, as the larger posterior part, whereas the smaller anterior part connecting the olfactory part. This is the temporal lobe connected by the larger posterior part. So that represents the anterior commissure. Whereas looking into the next one, that is the posterior commissure. Now posterior commissure no doubt lies exactly opposite to the anterior commissure, where the anterior commissure lies. Now this is in relation again with respect to the same diagram, sagittal section, showing the medial aspect of the brain. So you can make out over here, as which has been labeled as the posterior commissure. Now this represents the posterior commissure, again a band of white matter fiber connecting the interconnecting the cerebral hemispheres. Now where exactly it is located? Now again, if you look into the diagram here, now this part, now this is this particular projection that you are seeing is considered to be the pineal gland. Now pineal gland in turn has two extensions which are considered to be as the inferior laminae and the superior laminae. Now the inferior laminae, if you look at the lower or the inferior laminae of the pineal gland, that is where the posterior commissure is located. So it is said to be located in the inferior laminae, in the inferior laminae of the stalk of the pineal gland. So stalk or the extension of the pineal gland, which has divided into inferior laminae, so that is where the posterior commissure is can be located, as situated with respect to the posterior commissure. Now the importance of the posterior commissure, now it plays an important role with respect to the pupillary light reflex. So this you will learn better way in physiology. I think you must be aware by this time that pupillary light reflex, if you trace the pupillary light reflex pathway, so that is how it will be related even to the posterior commissures, where the fibers are related to the posterior, where the fibers are related to the posterior, the pupillary light reflex pathway. Whereas the next next commissural group of fiber is considered to be the hippocampal commissure. Now hippocampal commissure again As the name suggests, hippocampal part. This is again one of the important part related to the limbic system as well. Now this is the one that that connects the right and left half of the hippocampal formation. Now hippocampal formation has its own has a different story altogether. Now this hippocampal formation is connected on either side by connecting fiber, which is called as the hippocampal commissure. Now this image, now the next image, now this is the fornix. As you can see here, the part of the entire part of the limbic system, we can make out the hippocampal part, an extension from that, or the columns of the fornix, the body, and the anterior columns as well, posterior and anterior columns. Now both of them are limbs are connected by this connecting part. So this band of white matter fiber is called as the hippocampal commissure. So that is how, which is related to the limbic system again. That was the fourth subdivision of the commissural fibers. We are still in the commissural fiber itself. The last one, or the one of the other category under the commissural fiber, would be the habenular commissure. So now, habenular commissure. Now this locating this commissure is again worth again. So now, like this is as I said earlier. Now this is a magnified view of the medial aspect of the medial surface of the brain, where you can make out the pineal gland, the stalk of the pineal gland, and the extension, the laminae. This is the inferior laminae where we had seen the posterior commissure, and this is the superior laminae of the pineal gland. Now on the superior lamina of the pineal gland, we make out this group or bundle of fiber, white matter, white fibers, which are called as the habenular commissure. Now that is how. Now this is said to be like connects. It connects the habenular both sides of the diencephalon. So this now what exactly is the diencephalon? I hope you might be already very much familiar with this aspect also. Now diencephalon has again further five divisions or subdivision as thalamus, hypothalamus, subthalamus, meta and epithalamus. So altogether collectively it is called as the diencephalon. So that is how it helps in connecting these two aspects as well. So that was about again same. Now this image, slightly there is a mistake in labeling this part, so which was supposed to be labeled as habenular commissure, so it has been labeled as anterior. So no doubt this is not the anterior lies here, so this has to be the habenular commissure. You can ignore or be watchful with respect to labeling this particular part. So that was about the second group of white matter fibers, that is the commissural fibers, which were subdivided into five divisions for better understanding, as a corpus callosum, anterior commissure, posterior commissure, then habenular commissure, and the hippocampal commissure. So those were the five subdivisions under the commissural. Now the third subdivision, or the third part of the white matter fiber, would be the projection fibers. Now the projection fibers, as the name itself suggests, it projects projects or connects the different parts of the brain to the cortical areas, to the subcortical areas, or vice versa again, subcortical to the cortical areas again. Now those group or set of fibers are considered to be the projection fibers, connecting the cortex to the subcortical areas. Now what are the subcortical areas? So again, these are some of the important subcortical areas, as a corpus striatum. So this is a part of the basal ganglion that we'll see in the next coming classes. The thalamus, part of the diencephalon, the brainstem, as well as the spinal cord, all of them are in turn connected directly or indirectly with the this third set of fiber, that is the projection fiber. Now projection fibers are again for better understanding, depending on what they connect, they are categorized as as a corticofugal and corticopetal fibers. Corticofugal, wherein fibers go away from the cortex towards the subcortical areas, and the petal are nothing but from the subcortical areas to the cortical parts in the central nervous system. So that is how these two sets of fibers have been categorized for a better understanding of the projection fibers. Next, again, just like just like the association fibers, which was divided into short and long, commissural into a different set of subdivisions as a commissural fibers. Now, same way again, the best example for projection fibers would be two important tracts, it's a well-known tracts as the internal capsule and the fornix. So no doubt fornix is a part of the limbic system, as I said here, so a part of the limbic system, whereas this is the one that the internal capsule forms and holds a very very important relevance, because this is the part from examination point of view, so can be a 5 marker or as a 10 marker question. Apart from being that, this will convey the large bunch or group of white matter fibers from the cortex to the subcortical and vice versa. So that's how the internal capsule forms a very important aspect. Now we will look slightly in detail about the internal capsule, since being asked very commonly in examination as a being as a 5 marker or as a 10 marker question. So it has to be learnt under headings as parts or the subdivisions of internal capsule, and the fibers which are passing through the individual part of the internal capsule, the blood supply, and last but not the least would be the applied aspect related to the internal capsule. So that will slightly go in detail about the internal capsule. Now, internal capsule location first. This is nothing but a compact. Now, this is nothing but consists of a bundle of white matter fibers. So, bundle of white matter fibers. Now, they are present. The bundle of white matter fibers, which are present in such a way that, or which are located, or which can be pointed out to be present between the head of the caudate nucleus and the thalamus medially. Now, this is like we are seeing the cerebrum from horizontal section of the cerebral hemisphere has been done. The upper part of the cerebrum has been removed. Now, you are seeing the lower part from top. So, that is how we are seeing. Now, this is the right half of the cerebral hemisphere from the top. Now, the left half will be on the other side. So, keeping that in mind, so this is the, if you consider this one as the midline. Now, considering that, now this would be the medial structures which are seen. Now, this entire green colored area with yellow colored areas also seen over here equally. So, now this entire region, V-shaped region, is considered to be the internal capsule. Now, this internal capsule is said to be located between the head of the caudate nucleus. It is again a part of the basal ganglion. We'll see that about it later in the coming classes. And the thalamus, part of the diencephalon. So, medially it is present between the head of the caudate and the thalamus. Laterally, it is related to the lentiform nucleus. Now, this is again a biconvex or lens-shaped structure. This is again a gray matter area, which is called as the lentiform nucleus, has been labeled it as a lentiform nucleus. So, this is again a part of a basal ganglion that we'll see in the coming classes. So, that is how you can describe the location of the internal capsule has to be present or bounded medially by head of the caudate nucleus and thalamus, laterally by the lentiform nucleus. So that is how we can define the boundaries of the internal capsule. Now, what exactly this consists of? So as I told you earlier, so these are the projection fibers consisting of bundle or group of projection fibers, consisting of both ascending and descending tracts connecting cortical to subcortical and vice versa. So that is how the constituents of the internal capsule can be described containing the tracts, ascending and descending tracts. Those tracts of fibers, again for better understanding, as categorized into afferent and efferent fibers. Afferent are considered more sensory, like from the thalamus to the cortex, so which get it towards the cortex from thalamus are considered to be afferent, whereas equally important are motor fibers that they take down from the cortex to the lower cortical, subcortical areas, which pass through the cerebral peduncle of the midbrain, are considered to be the motor fibers which are present as a fiber, which are present as a group of fibers in the internal capsule. Now, This internal capsule, the role played by the internal capsule is, or the functional importance is responsible for innervation of the opposite half of the body, since because of the crossing of the fibers that happens. So, so that is the reason why it is considered to be like the innervating the opposite half of the body. Whereas now again, same image as I said earlier. So now this is again slightly magnified view. So this entire thing is a V-shaped structure that you are seeing here. We'll see the other shape and the parts of the internal capsule. So that is about the internal capsule. Now shape, as I said earlier, considering to be a V-shaped structure over seen over here. Now this V-shaped structure is present in such a way that the concavity of the V should be directed laterally. As I said earlier also, this is the midline medial aspect, this is the lateral aspect. So the concavity of the V should be directed laterally. So that is how you should always be oriented when you are describing the shape and relation of the internal capsule. Now it is divided into again say about 4 to 5 parts. Now the parts are as anterior limb. So this part is called as anterior limb for better description. Anterior limb is the one which is present between the head of the caudate nucleus and the lentiform nucleus. Now this entire thing, biconvex shaped lens like appearance, gray matter, is the lentiform nucleus. Now this is the anterior part. For descriptive purpose, we divide an anterior part and the posterior part. Now the anterior limb is present between the head of the caudate nucleus and the anterior part of the lentiform nucleus, whereas the posterior part is the one which is again present between the posterior part of the lentiform nucleus and the thalamus. That's this region is the posterior limb of the internal capsule. The one which is present between anterior and the posterior limb is considered to be the bent, that is the genu of the internal capsule. So that is how to describe the third part of the three parts. And the two other parts would be the retrolentiform and the sublentiform. So keeping in relation, staying in relation with the lentiform nucleus, the one which is behind, exactly behind the lentiform nucleus, is considered to be the retrolentiform. Whereas the one which is not evident from this sectional view, which is found to be like located beneath the lentiform nucleus, is considered to be the sublentiform part of the internal capsule. So that is how the five parts of the internal capsule has to be remembered. Whereas applied aspect, we'll go in detail about it in the end of this particular part. Now, like this is how controls, especially related to the sensory and motor aspect. So it will the opposite half of the body. If we'll look into the detail about this upper aspect, especially in the next slides, in the after this particular slide. Now this thing is important again. So now we have we have learnt about the parts of the internal capsule as to be as anterior limb, posterior limb, the bent genu, and the retrolentiform and the sublentiform part. Now we also know that what exactly is the internal capsule, or the constituents of internal capsule, or what is present inside the internal capsule would be the bundle of the white matter fiber, that is in the sense the fibers from the cortex to subcortical and cortical to subcortical to cortical areas. Now these are the sets or group of fibers which has to pass through the different parts of the internal capsule. So it becomes again slightly mandatory, more or less mandatory to mug up the tracks which pass through these parts of the internal capsule. Now if you look at the anterior limb, so what are the motor fibers and the sensory set of fibers that are related or pass through this anterior limb? So mainly the corticopan. Now in the next slide we'll look into the how exactly the fibers are further categorized. Now this is like the actual set of fibers that are related to the parts of the internal capsule. The anterior limb, the motor fibers would be like corticopontine, from the cortex to the pontine, are considered to be these to be located in the anterior limb. And same way with respect to the sensory, now this is something called as a radiations, like the fibers extending from the thalamus. Now that we'll see in the coming slides again. So as of now, remember the anterior from the thalamus, four sets of radiations or fibers extend towards the cortex. They are categorized as anterior, posterior, superior and inferior thalamic radiation, which are the sensory set of fibers, because it will convey the sensory impulses from thalamus to the cortex, the higher center in the cortex. So that is how they are categorized as radiations, as anterior, posterior, superior and inferior thalamic radiation. So that we'll see that later. As of now, remember, anterior limb, corticopontine fibers passes through them, and sensory would be the anterior thalamic. Now, genu also conveys allows the passage of corticopontine fibers along with the corticopontine, corticonuclear and corticospinal, going to the brainstem, corticonuclear, going to the spinal cord, corticospinal, related to the head and neck region. So they pass through along with corticopontine. Now, one thing would be common to all the parts would be the corticopontine. So corticopontine are seen in and through, running in and through these all the parts of the internal capsule, so that can remain as a static type of fibers, whereas the sensory superior thalamic radiation as a sensory set of fibers which are seen in the genu. Now, posterior limb, same corticopontine plus corticospinal and corticorubral, so this related to the other than the head and neck region, as a upper limb trunk and the lower limb fibers are allowed to pass through this one, that pass through the posterior limb. Whereas the retrolentiform is related to the, again, exclusively to the corticopontine, and the related to the visual pathway, the optic radiation. Whereas the sublentiform is again corticopontine motor, whereas sensory would be the auditory fibers. So that is how the set of fibers that pass through the different aspects of the internal capsule. Now this is again the other diagram, which shows about the fibers, a categorization of the group of fibers as a corticopontine, for subdivisions of corticopontine. Now the corticonuclear set of fibers in the genu, and the posterior and the corticospinal set of fibers, and the corticorubral and the parietopontine other fibers. So that is how the fibers location can be mentioned with respect to diagram. Now, like a slightly in detail about the fibers. Now, what we learned about that the internal capsule consists of three sets of fibers for better descriptive understanding, as a corticopontine, pyramidal, and extrapyramidal fibers. Now, these are the three basic sets of fibers which are seen in the entire as a bunch of fibers passing through the internal capsule. Now, we can go further slightly in detail. So, I will go in brief about these fibers as well. Now, first, if you take up, now remember, the entire internal capsule consists of these three sets of fibers only. So, as corticopontine, pyramidal, and extrapyramidal. Now, first, if you take up the corticopontine, now this corticopontine is considered to be like it will share a largest share of set of fibers in the internal capsule, compared to pyramidal and extrapyramidal. So this almost about a 2/3 of the total number of fibers which are present in the internal capsule, they belong to corticopontine. Now again, if you take up the corticopontine, now this corticopontine is a generalized term. Now this in turn is further subdivided for better understanding or finer detail, depending on what lobe or the four lobes of the cerebrum, from four lobes. Now this corticopontine is further subdivided into four sets of fiber, as fronto, parieto, occipito, and temporopontine fibers. So these are the four sets of fibers, subsets of fibers of the corticopontine fibers. Now, as the name itself suggests, quite easier, from frontal, parietal, and occipital, four lobes will convey the motor set of fibers passing through the all of the passages of the internal to the internal capsule. Now, these are the four sets. Now, if you look into the frontopontine, from the frontal, now these will pass through the posterior limb and the genu. Now, parieto and occipitopontine, they pass through the retrolentiform part of the, now as you can be labeled over here, parieto and the occipitopontine, they pass through the retrolentiform part of the internal capsule, whereas the temporopontine, they pass through the sublentiform. So this is mainly concerned with the auditory aspect, so they have to pass through the sublentiform part of the internal capsule. Now again, point again, what to be remembered is the corticopontine functional importance. Now the corticopontine, all the corticopontine, they relay into a set of nuclei, that is the pontine nuclei, but that too, especially the same side, ipsilateral pontine nuclei. But it is from ipsilateral set of fibers, from ipsilateral pontine nuclei, they pass on to the opposite side. So fibers from there cross the midline and go to the opposite aspect, and those fibers are collectively called as corticopontocerebellar pathway. So the entire story about the corticopontocerebellar pathway is like they start from the cortex, they end in the ipsilateral pontine nuclei, and from then the fibers will run onto the opposite side of the cerebral hemisphere, so which constitutes this pathway. So that is how related to the first set. Now the second set of fiber, internal capsule, has the pyramidal fibers. So as now these fibers arise from the cortex and definitely go to the lower motor neuron in the brainstem and the spinal cord. Now this again for descriptive purpose has two subdivisions, as corticonuclear and corticospinal. Now corticonuclear fibers are nothing but, as the name itself suggests, they start from the cortex, but cerebral cortex, and end up in the nuclei located in the brainstem, that is the motor cranial nerve nuclei, which are located in the brainstem, which are connected with innervating the head and neck muscle. So the corticonuclear, they pass through the genu of the internal capsule. So genu of the internal capsule will allow the passage of the corticonuclear fibers. This is the first set of pyramidal. The second set of pyramidal fiber would be corticospinal. As the name is suggests, from the cortex to the spinal cord, lower level beyond the brainstem, they innervate again the muscles of the upper limb, trunk, and the lower limb. So they are the one, they occupy the posterior limb of the internal capsule. So as you can make out over here, so this will be the corticospinal fibers. So that is about the second set. Now third set would be the set of fibers passing through the internal capsule or the extra pyramidal fibers. Now these are considered to be extra pyramidal in the sense, apart from being the pyramidal aspect of the cerebrum. Now what are the extra pyramidal system? Extra pyramidal system, if you are aware, so consists of basically the red nucleus, corpus striatum, and the substantia nigra. So that will in turn regulate the voluntary activities of the body. So those are again controlled by the extrapyramidal system. So these fibers, they again pass through the through the internal capsule. So most of them occupy the posterior limb of the internal capsule, this region over here. So it will be occupied by the extrapyramidal fibers, which occupy the posterior limb of the internal capsule. Whereas with respect to the motor fibers, now if we look into the sensory aspect of the sensory set of fibers that pass through the internal capsule, would be categorized or is categorized into four different set of fibers or group of fibers which will extend from the thalamus. So which are labeled as the or considered as the radiations extending from the thalamus. So if you consider this diagram, in the diagram, from the fibers which are extending anteriorly are considered to be the anterior thalamic radiation, the posterior thalamic radiation, superior and inferior. So these are the sensory set of or group of fibers, so that will convey the sensory impulses from a thalamus to the higher centers of the brain for analysis, better analysis of the sensory impulses. So these are sensory fibers. Now anterior, if I take up individually, the anterior thalamic radiations, so no doubt they are connected with respect to the frontal lobe from the thalamus. So they are the one which are again, where exactly are they located? So you can even mention with respect to the internal capsule. Now, so they are best located with respect to the anterior limb and even the genu of the internal capsule, where you can make out the anterior thalamic radiation. Whereas the posterior thalamic radiation, so directed, no doubt they are directed, as you can, if you can see from here this diagram. So the posterior thalamic radiation, so this is the one which is exclusively concerned with the pathway of the vision, visual pathway. So before they end up into the primary visual cortex area, so they have to come in relation with the retrolentiform part of the internal capsule that is exclusively related to the visual pathway, on the visual pathway. Apart from that, the fibers they are related to the lateral geniculate body. From there, the fibers project as the considered with the optic radiation before they project onto the primary area of visual cort. I mean, primary visual area in the occipital lobe. They have to pass through these parts, especially the retrolentiform part of the internal capsule that comes into play with respect to the internal capsule. Whereas the third set, now superior thalamic radiation from here to these aspects now, especially related to the frontal and even the parietal lobes connected to that part. So from here, that is especially these nuclei, ventral group of nuclei, the thalamus, to the frontal and the parietal lobes connection to this one. So they again related, I mean, they in relation to internal capsule, so they pass or related to the anterior limb of the internal capsule. Whereas the inferior set, now they are exclusively related to the or connected with respect to the auditory radiation or auditory pathway going on towards the temporal lobe, as you can make out here. So temporal lobe. Now they occupy the sublentiform. So retro, mind you again, retrolentiform is concerned with the optic radiation, whereas whereas the sublentiform is exclusively related to the auditory impulses or the pathway, so which pass through the primary auditory area, that is area number 21-22 in the superior temporal gyrus. So that is how the sensory pathway can be traced with respect to the internal capsule. Now, last but not the least would be the blood supply of the internal capsule. Now, blood supply of the internal capsule can be categorized as you can remember it in the form of the parts as well. Now, as you can make out here, the diagram. Now, this is the internal carotid artery dividing into the anterior cerebral and the middle cerebral artery. Now, this is the posterior. Now, this is the basilar artery dividing into the posterior cerebral artery. Now, now this is the outlay of the layout of the internal capsule as certain parts as anterior, the geno posterior limb, and the sub and the retrolentiform parts. Now, if you take up the anterior limb and the geno, so the anterior limb and geno, they are supplied by branches from the, to be simple, as the branches from the anterior cerebral artery. Or if you wish to be more specific, as striatal branches, or one among that is considered the recurrent branch of the Hebner's artery, so as a branch from the anterior cerebral artery supplying the anterior limb and the geno of the internal capsule, whereas the posterior limb is said to be supplied by branches from the middle cerebral artery, as you can make out here. So internal carotid artery and the middle cerebral artery supplies, especially as a medial and lateral striatal branches. Now, a point again worth to be remembered is one among that lateral striatal branch is considered to be quite larger and very frequently involved in cerebral vascular accidents or the rupture, ruptural conditions. So that particular artery, they label it as a Charcot's artery of cerebral hemorrhage, which is very frequently involved in rupture when it happens. So that is how you can remember it as a clinical aspect again, with respect to clinical aspect as well. Charcot's artery very commonly involved in artery involved in hemorrhage, leading to again a set of clinical features. But the sublentiform part supplied by central, again from especially the posterior. Now sublentiform part, now this is the posterior cerebral artery supplies the sublentiform part of the internal capsule. Whereas the retrolentiform equally again supplied by branches from the posterior cerebral. So sub and retro are both are supplied as a branches from the posterior cerebral artery. The applied aspect related to the internal capsule would be any injury in the form of rupture of the Charcot's artery, which is nothing but one of the lateral striatal branch of the middle cerebral artery. So if it is involved, leads to loss of sensation and the spastic type of paralysis. Mind you again, spastic, why spastic? Because any upper motor neuron lesions leads to spastic type of paralysis. There is one more set as the flaccid, if at all, if the lower motor neurons are involved, so therein we come across the flaccid. But otherwise here, the opposite half of the body suffers from loss of sensation and spastic type of paralysis. Now cause, Charcot's artery, involvement of this this artery. Whereas again, equally important, Hebner's artery can also result in, if at all, if it is involved in rupture, leading to hemorrhage and gives rise to a set of clinical symptoms as well. So that is about the applied aspect related to the internal capsule. So this is again worth remembering. So that is how, by this again, we come to end of today's topic related to the white matter and most importantly, the internal capsule of the internal capsule. So thank you very much.
Okay, good afternoon. Let us move on to today's topic, tubular reabsorption. So morning I had told about this scheme. So in today's class, we'll be learning in detail about renal handling of mainly the sodium ions, water molecules, and the glucose. So in this diagram, I was just asked you to focus on this. So this is a kettle with the blood. Let us imagine the kettle with the tea, with all the tea leaves in it. So when we pour it onto the filter, the tea leaves will get separated, which can be compared to the blood cells and the proteins present in the blood. So apart from this, blood cells and proteins, everything will get filtered and finally it will lead to the formation of ultrafiltrate. So this is called ultrafiltrate because it is seen as that of plasma, but only thing is it is devoid of proteins. So that is why this filtrate is called the ultrafiltrate. Whereas the tonicity is concerned, as far as the tonicity is concerned, the osmolarity is same as that of the plasma, and therefore this can be compared. The large volume of protein-free plasma will be collected in the Bowman space. So this is purely about the glomerular filtration, which is the first step involved in the urine formation. So coming to the next step, once the filtrate is formed, so don't concentrate on the labeling and other things. It is just a general figure. Just concentrate. What will happen to the filtrate? Once the filtrate enters into the Bowman space, it has to pass through the tubular lumen. So as it is passing through the tubular lumen, it will undergo sequential changes because of addition of substances and also removal of substances. If you observe the color carefully, so there is a change in the color as well. So on the upper portion, that is in the outer cortex, the cortical area, you can see the osmolarity of the fluid almost, it is lesser than that of the medullary filtrate, isn't it? So this is because as the filtrate is passing down, when the solutes are getting added into the filtrate, the osmolarity of the filtrate will go on increasing. And as it passes to the distal tubule and the collecting duct, here also there is change in the osmolarity. And finally, when it reaches the collecting tubule, which opens into the renal pelvis, again the osmolarity of the filtrate will be increased, and this is going to, we call it as the urine. So this urine will get collected in the pelvis, and finally it will be drained via the ureter to the urinary bladder, and it will be avoided in the form of urine by micturition. So here, just observe carefully, some people, they are showing, some are trying to remove the substances away from the tubular lumen, and this process is comparable to reabsorption. That means to tell, whatever the useful substances which are needed by the body, so that will be removed by the tubular epithelial cells. Okay, and this process is called tubular reabsorption. And here you can see, someone is pouring something into the tubular lumen. So when the substances are secreted or released by the tubular cells into the tubular lumen, that process is called tubular secretion. So in today's class, we'll be concentrating mainly on tubular reabsorption. So before discussing tubular reabsorption proper, first understand, urinary excretion is equal to three processes. It is the result of three important processes: the glomerular filtration, the tubular reabsorption, and the tubular secretion. So for glomerular filtration means it is the filtered blood, which is nothing but the ultrafiltrate, which is deprived of plasma proteins. So this will have large amount of solute load along with the water molecules. If some of the water molecules and the solutes are being removed by means of tubular reabsorption, then, and if some of the substances are added to the filtrate, that will give the urine, that will determine the final concentration of the urine excreted. So this tubular reabsorption, compared to the glomerular filtration process, it is highly selective phenomenon. This mainly depends on the type of substances and also the need of the body for these substances as well. Some of the substances like glucose, amino acids, after they get filtered, so they will be completely reabsorbed. That means they exhibit 100% of reabsorption. If the reabsorption is 100%, that means to tell these substances at any cost, they are not going to appear in the urine. Whereas some of the substances, like especially the ions like sodium, chloride and bicarbonate, even though the rate of reabsorption is very high, it will be around about 99.4% or 6% also. But the excretion rate is variable because this mainly depends on the need of the body. Whereas some of the substances like urea and creatinine, they are poorly reabsorbed because the body, it doesn't want to keep these metabolic waste products. They are the nitrogenous waste products. They need to be thrown out of the body. So that is the reason these substances exhibit lesser amount of reabsorption. And therefore, this tubular reabsorption process, it is a highly selective phenomenon. So now you know, reabsorption, it mainly concentrates on the removal of essential substances from the tubular lumen into the renal epithelial cells, isn't it? So for that, we require some special equipments. The renal tubule, the tubular epithelial cells, they are equipped with some of the carrier proteins like the pumps. Pumps are nothing but they are the electrogenic pump. They mainly depend on ATP for their function. So these are mainly responsible for active transport mechanism. And this is mediated by carrier proteins. So we have three different types of carrier proteins. Uniport, which is a carrier protein which transports the substance in any of one direction. Symport, it has the ability to transport two substances in the same direction. antipode, it has the ability to transport substances in the opposite direction. Then we also require channels which will facilitate the diffusion of some of the ions like chloride channels, potassium channels, etc. And the last important mode of transport mechanism which is observed mainly in the renal tubular epithelial cells is transcytosis. Probably you would have learned in general physiology the special transport mechanism, the transcytosis. So today you will be understanding what is this transcytosis, and this is mainly seen in the renal tubular epithelial cells. So this is a diagram showing some of the carrier proteins. If the carrier protein is able to transport the substance in one direction, it is uniport. If it is able to transport two substances in the same direction, it is symport. It is also called co-transport mechanism. Symport is also called co-transport mechanism. Then if the substances are transported in opposite direction, look at the arrow. S1, the substance 1 is coming in, S2, the substance 2 is going out. So this is called antipode. This is also called counter transport mechanism or exchanger mechanism. So this protein is also called exchanger. Okay, so please understand these terminologies. You have to write it and practice. So uniport, symport, antipod. The symport and antipod, they are together constitute the co-transport mechanism. So all these transport mechanisms are very important for the transport of substances from the tubular lumen into the renal tubular cells, from there to the renal interstitium and to the peritubular capillaries. So this is a diagrammatic representation just to show how the substances from the tubular lumen will be entering into the peritubular capillaries. So let us imagine this is the renal tubular epithelial cells, and here the blue color represents the glomerular filtrate which is coming from the Bowman space into the tubular lumen. So this filtrate, it undergoes sequential changes as it passes down, and once the substances are reabsorbed, that means these substances are taken up by the renal tubular cells, it will be sent to the medullary interstitium. So this is the interstitial space between the renal tubular epithelial cells. And from the interstitium, the substances can directly, the substances will go into the peritubular capillaries. And at this point, I want to make a note, please make a note here. The substances to enter from the tubular lumen across the tubular epithelial cells, they require carrier proteins. That is, if they want to pass through the apical membrane and if they want to pass through the basal membrane, so they need carrier proteins. The carrier proteins are present in the cell membrane of the tubular epithelial cells. Whereas once the substances enter the medullary interstitium, it is mainly because of the pressure gradient. So here comes the operation of the Starling forces, like your hydrostatic pressure, the oncotic pressure, which you will be understanding in the subsequent slide. So finally, the substances will reach the peritubular capillaries. Only then the process is called reabsorption. Okay, so reabsorption, it mainly refers to the transport of substances from the tubular lumen into the peritubular capillaries. So that was just a rough diagram. In the body, the tubular epithelial cell will look like this. So this is the tubular lumen, and here you can see filtration. That is, the glomeruli, they are contributing for the filtration of the whole blood, and finally ultrafiltrate will be formed that will be entering into the lumen. And this filtrate, it is having a huge quantity of water and the solute molecules, and these substances can be taken inside the renal tubular epithelial cells by two methods, okay, by two pathways these substances will be entering into the renal epithelial cells. So this is the renal epithelial cell, and if you observe carefully, this is the brush border and this is facing the lumen, and therefore this is called the apical membrane of the renal tubular cell, and this is the basal side of the renal tubular cell. And in between the cells, if you observe carefully, the cells, the adjacent cells, they are tightly attached to each other, and they are mainly connected through gap junctions. You know what are these gap junctions or the tight junctions. So these junctions are also playing a major role in the transport of substances from the tubular lumen into the interstitium. And if the substances take this route for the transport, then it is called paracellular pathway. paracellular pathway, which is mainly through the junctions or tight junctions present between the adjacent renal tubular epithelial cells. If the substances are entering through the apical membrane and if they are passing through the basal membrane to the interstitium, this route is called transcellular pathway, which is nothing but transcytosis. Because here the substances, they have to pass through series of membrane, isn't it? So first comes the apical membrane, then comes the basal membrane. So this is the transcellular pathway. So these are the different pathways which is taken by the substances to reach the medullary interstitium from the tubular lumen, and from there in turn to the peritubular capillary, that is the bloodstream. And here you can make out it is whether it is renal epithelial cell or whether it is intestinal epithelial cell. Any human cell, if you take the basal membrane of the cell, it is always provided with electrogenic pump, that is sodium potassium pump. You have already learnt about the role of sodium potassium pump in the genesis of the RMP, resting membrane potential. So this membrane is mainly responsible for the maintenance of intracellular sodium concentration at low, and it also contribute for the negativity of the cell interior. So this is the main driving force for the ions to enter from the tubular lumen to the inside of the renal tubular epithelial cells. So this is causing, or this is creating a gradient which will facilitate the movement of ions from the tubular lumen into the renal epithelial cells. Once the substances are entering the interstitium, that is the interstitial space, okay, so then they will be entering into the peritubular capillary by means of bulk flow. Bulk flow you will understand in the further slides. So this process is the reabsorption. And finally, after the solutes and water, it has been reabsorbed. Whatever is left in the tubular lumen will be excreted in the form of urine. So this process is called excretion. So this I have already explained with the diagram. So these are the two different routes taken by the substances. Transcellular route means the substances, they have to cross the apical membrane, apical cell membrane, that is which is facing towards the lumen, and the basal membrane as well. Whereas the paracellular route, it is mainly through the junctional spaces between the cells, and this space is called lateral intercellular space also. Sodium takes both the routes for its entry into the interstitium. Now, what is the purpose of reabsorption? By now, you have got an idea. The main purpose of reabsorption is to push all the required nutrient, all the required substances like the solutes, okay, which may be ions like sodium, potassium, chloride, bicarbonate, or the organic substances like glucose, amino acids, etc., and also the water molecules, they need to be transported from the tubular lumen back to the bloodstream. So this is the process of reabsorption. So meanwhile, they have to pass through the renal tubular epithelial cells, the medullary interstitium, and also the peritubular capillary. So what is the solute load? As I told, once the ultrafiltrate is formed, it will have certain amount of solutes. So in that solute concentration, the required quantity of the necessary substances which are needed by the body in order to maintain the homeostasis, so they will be reabsorbed. So in a day, about 180, the normal GFR is about 125 ml per minute or 180 liters per day. So if you want to calculate the filtered load of any substance, for that you must know the plasma concentration of that substance multiplied by GFR will give you the filtered load of a particular substance. So in an average person, though, who is healthy, physically fit and fine, the filtered load will have, the filtrate will have 54,000 milliosmoles of the total solute concentration. In that, 53,400 milliosmoles of solutes will be reabsorbed, 100 milliosmoles of solutes will be secreted, and secretion, it mainly involves certain substances which you will be learning in tomorrow's class in detail. So the remaining 700 milliosmoles of the solutes will be excreted out of this total amount of the solute load. Okay, so the total percentage of reabsorption for the solutes will be about 98.9%. So if you observe this, our kidneys are provided with a wonderful mechanism in order to retain the necessary substances which are very much needed by the body, isn't it? So coming to, so that was a brief introduction about the process of reabsorption. So now I'll be discussing in detail about the reabsorption of sodium. So if you take the sodium, in the previous slide you learned there will be a certain amount of filter load for the solutes, and in that the 26,000, okay, 26,000 the unit of sodium. Sodium, it is a predominantly positively charged ion which is present in the ECF. You all will be aware of this. And the normal concentration of sodium is about 142 milliequivalents. So in a day, the filtered load for the sodium will be about 26,000. This actually you can calculate. As I'm telling, the plasma concentration is 142 multiplied by 180. So you calculate it and check. So it is about 26,000 milliequivalents. So in that 26,000 milliequivalents, 25,850 molecules will be reabsorbed. Okay, and the secretion, that no point of time or no segment of the nephron has the ability to secrete sodium ions. It has to purely depend on the amount of sodium present in the blood. Okay, now 150 molecules of the sodium will be excreted per day, and therefore the total percentage of reabsorption for the sodium is about 99.4%. Okay, so the total reabsorption for the sodium is about 99.4%. So the location, the site of absorption, the sodium is reabsorbed in the PCT, leukophendy, the distal convoluted tubule, as well as in the collecting duct. So let us see the mechanism. So how much percentage of sodium gets reabsorbed at different parts of the nephron? So in the PCT, about 60% of the filtered load of sodium will get reabsorbed. And this is contributed by many carrier proteins, among which primarily by the sodium hydrogen exchanger. So it is an antiport. It has the ability to transport two substances, that is sodium and hydrogen ion, in the opposite direction. Obviously, sodium will be allowed to enter in and in exchange for hydrogen ion. So in the leukophendy, especially the thick ascending limb of leukophendy, it is permeable to sodium ions. It is permeable means, if I mention a particular segment, it is freely permeable means it is allowing the substance to enter into the renal tubular cells. So the thick ascending limb of leukophendy is allowing 30% of sodium reabsorption with the help of a carrier protein. So this is very important, please make a note. And this carrier protein is called sodium 2-chloride potassium cotransporter. Okay, sodium 2-chloride potassium cotransporter. Again, I'll be explaining with the diagram. Then the distal convoluted tubule, 7% of the sodium will get reabsorbed with the help of sodium chloride cotransporter. Okay, the carrier protein which is mainly responsible here for the reabsorption of sodium is sodium chloride cotransporter. And the last one is the collecting duct. It contributes for 3% of sodium reabsorption, and under the influence of special channels called ENaC channels. They are called ENaC channels, that is epithelial sodium channels, epithelial sodium channels. So coming to the reabsorption of sodium in the proximal convoluted tubule. The carrier proteins, as I told, it has many number of carrier proteins which play a major role in the transport of sodium at the PCT. So among them, the most important ones are the sodium glucose cotransporter. So this you have already come across in GIT, in the absorption of glucose. There also this particular carrier protein was mentioned, isn't it? So sodium glucose cotransporter was this mainly contribute for the transport of one molecule of sodium and one molecule of glucose into the renal tubular epithelial cells from the tubular lumen. So it is also called symporter. Next comes the sodium phosphate cotransporter. So if you observe carefully, you have sodium amino acid cotransporter, sodium lactate cotransporter. So all these molecules, they are getting passively transported along with the sodium, and all these are example for secondary active transport mechanism. Okay, so the other example for secondary active transport mechanisms are sodium phosphate cotransporter, sodium amino acid cotransporter, sodium lactate cotransporter. So these carrier proteins, they transport mainly the sodium along with inorganic phosphate ions, amino acid and lactate ions from the tubular lumen into the renal tubular epithelial cells. The most important carrier protein, which is mainly responsible for the uptake of sodium by the renal tubular cells, is by sodium hydrogen exchanger. Here you concentrate. This particular carrier protein, it is a counter transport mechanism, isn't it? So it has the ability to transport one molecule of sodium from the tubular lumen into the tubular epithelial cells in exchange for another positive ion. Okay, therefore it is called exchanger. And last one is chloride base exchanger. This I have just mentioned just to name the carrier proteins which are present in the PCT. So this is not having a role in the reabsorption of sodium, but this is very important in order to maintain the electrode neutrality. Once the sodium ions start entering inside the renal tubular cells, the new electrode neutrality will be altered. So to some extent, this is contributed by the chloride ions, the influx of chloride ions, that you will understand. So coming to the mechanism. So here at the PCT, as you all are aware, PCT is a proximal convoluted tubule. And here the ions, they have to pass through the apical membrane and they have to pass through the basal membrane. So let us see what are the changes that are observed, or what is the mechanism that is occurring at the apical membrane of the proximal convoluted tubular epithelial cells. So here the active transport of sodium is coupled with the co-transport of glucose, amino acids and also inorganic phosphates, etc. via the symporters. Okay, so this is the main mechanism. So this is mainly by secondary active transport mechanism, because here the transport of sodium is coupled with glucose, amino acids and the inorganic phosphate, etc. Next, the sodium reabsorption is also coupled with secretion of H plus ion. So I am introducing secretion of H plus ion. That means the tubular epithelial cells which are present in the PCT, they are contributing for the secretion of H plus ions in exchange for sodium ions. So these are the different carrier proteins which are mainly responsible for the reabsorption of sodium in the proximal convoluted tubule. So this is the proximal tubular epithelial cells with the tubular lumen here, and this is the peritubular capillary. And now the sodium is present, abundantly present in the tubular lumen. Okay. As you all aware, the cell interior is negative. Normally, when the cell is at rest, the RMP will be negative. The cell interior will be negative. So the electrical gradient is favoring the sodium ions because it is positively charged and cell interior is negative. So the electrical gradient is favoring the sodium ions, and also the concentration gradient. If you look at the intracellular sodium concentration, this is kept very low because of the presence of electrogenic pump, the sodium potassium pump. So because of this, the concentration gradient is also favoring the sodium ions to enter in from the tubular lumen. So this is the initial driving force for the movement of sodium ions from the tubular lumen into the renal tubular epithelial cells. So once the sodium ions comes and binds with the carrier proteins, it will attract all the other molecules, the glucose, amino acids, the phosphate, etc. They all bind to the carrier protein and they all will be transported from the tubular lumen to inside of the renal tubular epithelial cells. And there is a dotted line shown here. It also involves the passive transport mechanism. Wherever you come across the dotted line in the diagram, it is for the transport, the passive transport mechanism. And this, the solid line represents the active transport mechanism. So here the active transport is electrode, that is sodium potassium pump. And this passive diffusion, it is mainly through the sodium. It takes both paracellular pathway as well as the transcellular pathway to enter from the tubular lumen into the renal tubular epithelial cells. So once the sodium ions start entering in, as I told, the electron neutrality will get disturbed. So this will be maintained by the passive invert diffusion of the chloride ions via the chloride channels, because along the concentration gradient. Okay, so now you know the cell interior was negative, it was attracting the positive ion, that is the sodium ions, to enter in, and also the concentration gradient was also favoring the sodium ions to enter in from the tubular lumen into the renal tubular epithelial cells. Here, see, as the sodium ions started entering in, the electron neutrality will get altered. So this is maintained by the passive invert or the influx of chloride ions from the tubular lumen into the cell through the chloride channels. Okay, so this is a passive transport mechanism because the concentration gradient is favoring the chloride ions. You all know chloride is abundantly present in ECF than ICF. So it is along the concentration gradient the chloride ions diffuses into the tubular epithelial cells, and this is a negatively charged ion, and it is trying to balance or trying to maintain the electrical neutrality. The second one, these cells, the tubular epithelial cells of the PCT, they have one important enzyme called carbonic anhydrase. So this enzyme you have come across in many places as well, even in the cerebrospinal fluid, means even in the brain also we have told about this carbonic anhydrase. This mainly catalyzes the conversion of the carbon dioxide, which is continuously released as a result of tissue metabolic activity. So this combines with the water molecules to form a weak acid called H2CO3. So this weak acid H2CO3 will dissociate into H plus and HCO3 minus. So this HCO3 minus, being a negative ion along with the chloride ion, will try to maintain the electron neutrality of the tubular epithelial cell. Now coming to the transport of sodium and other substances at the level of the PCT. So this is the tubular lumen and this is the renal tubular epithelial cells. I have just shown the interstitial fluid. I have not shown the peritubular capillaries here. So now from the tubular lumen, as I told, there is the initial driving force for the sodium ions to enter in. Both electrical and chemical gradient is favoring the sodium ions. The sodium ions first comes and bind with the carrier protein, sodium glucose co-transporter, sodium amino acid co-transporter, sodium amino acid co-transporter and sodium phosphate co-transporter, all other co-transporters. So when it binds to the carrier protein, there will be conformational changes in the carrier protein, and this carrier protein will not transport the sodium until and unless the other molecule, that is the glucose or the amino acid or the phosphate, binds to the carrier protein. So only when both the molecules get bind to this carrier protein, it will become activated. There will be conformational changes in the protein, and it will allow the glucose and sodium molecules to enter inside the renal tubular epithelial cells. Now the sodium has entered in, the glucose also has entered in. The name of this carrier protein is very important. It is called SGLT2, the sodium glucose transporter, SGLT2. It is given some names, SGLT1, SGLT2. Why I am stressing on this is because these days the diabetes has become very common, and the incidence also is increasing, both incidence and prevalence. In order to prevent, they are trying for the newer drugs. So presently they are concentrating on blocking this particular carrier protein, that is SGLT2, in order to prevent the reabsorption of glucose at the level of PCT, because more percentage of glucose reabsorption will be occurring at the level of PCT. So that is the clinical importance of this particular carrier protein. So once the glucose enters in, it will freely diffuses into the medullary, it will freely diffuses into the interstitial fluid through a carrier protein. Okay, but this is not active transport, this is a facilitated diffusion. Okay, which is an example for passive transport mechanism. And the name of this particular protein, it is called GLUT2. Okay, the particular protein is called GLUT2. Here it is called SGLT2, sodium glucose transporter. Here it is called GLUT, glucose transporter protein 2. So with that, glucose will freely diffuse into the interstitium. In the same way, the other molecules, like this is the sodium amino acid co-transporter, which will transport amino acids into the epithelial cells and into the interstitial fluid. Here, so this I have shown separately because this is the carrier protein which is mainly contributing for the reabsorption of sodium from the tubular lumen into the epithelial cells. And this is sodium hydrogen exchanger. So here, for every one molecule of sodium to enter in, one H plus ion will be secreted into the tubular lumen. Because the H plus is released from the cell into the lumen, it is called secretion. Because the sodium ions are taken in from the tubular lumen into the cell, it is reabsorbed. Okay, so we cannot tell just because it is entering the cell, it is called reabsorption. Only when this sodium reaches the peritubular capillary, then only it is called the sodium has been reabsorbed. Okay, so these are the various carrier proteins which are mainly responsible for the transport of sodium at the PCT. Next, that was through the apical membrane. Now the sodium ions along with the other molecules like amino acids, glucose, it has entered in. So next, what happens? The step 2 is through the basolateral membrane. So at the basolateral membrane, as you all aware, the electrogenic pump, the sodium potassium pump is present. So it will have an eye on the entry of sodium ions and it will become activated. And once the positive ions are entering in, what will happen? Obviously, there will be change in the membrane potential. So this particular protein, that is this electrogenic pump, will get activated and it will start pushing the sodium ions from inside to outside. That is, it will transport 3 sodium ions in exchange for 2 potassium ions. Okay, or the net result will be it is contributing for negativity inside the cell. So 67% by it is mainly contributed by that is 67% of the sodium ions which have entered inside the cell will be pushed out by the electrogenic pump, sodium potassium pump, and remaining 33% is by solvent drag. So what is this solvent drag? So this diagram I have already explained, just concentrate here. So what is the solvent drag? As the sodium ions, they are thrown out of the cell into the interstitial space. So there will be a gradient for the efflux of chloride and bicarbonate as well. Sorry, it has been cut here. It is bicarbonate. Okay. So because the sodium influx, the influx of sodium is causing the influx of chloride and bicarbonate in order to maintain the electron neutrality. In the same way, the efflux of sodium, it is also making the efflux of the chloride and the bicarbonate ions again in order to maintain the electron neutrality. Okay, now as most of the solutes, they have moved out of the tubular epithelial cell. Okay, say the sodium and other solutes, they have moved out of the cell into the interstitium. So what will happen here? There is a low solute concentration and this will trigger the water molecules to move by osmosis. Osmosis is nothing but the process of the transport of water molecules, that is the solvent molecules, from a region of low solute concentration to a high solute concentration. So the movement of water molecules along with the solute from the cell to the interstitium and from there to the peritubular capillary, this is called the bulk flow. Because the water along with the solutes, they all will be moving towards the peritubular capillaries, and this is called the bulk flow or otherwise called the solvent drag. Now the osmotic, that is the osmosis, will begin and the water molecules will also start to move, and there will be bulk flow of water, sodium, chloride, bicarbonate into the capillaries. So what are the forces that determine the reabsorption of substances by the peritubular capillaries? I told in the beginning also. So these carrier proteins which I have mentioned, which are mainly causing the reabsorption of various substances, they are mainly present on the apical membrane and on the basal membrane. So these are mainly causing the reabsorption of various substances or the transport of various substances. Now, what is the force that is causing the movement of these substances from the interstitium to the peritubular capillaries? It is mainly because of two forces. One is the capillary hydrostatic pressure, PC, capillary hydrostatic pressure, that is within the peritubular capillary. Capillary means it is the peritubular capillary. And the colloidal osmotic pressure within the peritubular capillary, this is represented as pi C. Pi C, pi always refers to colloidal osmotic pressure. As you have already learned, hydrostatic pressure, whenever it is high, it will push the fluid or it will push the water or it will push the fluid out of the compartment. And the colloidal osmotic pressure, it will always try to retain the fluid within the compartment. But here, look at the values here. Now, the solutes have moved into the interstitium and look at the hydrostatic pressure in the interstitial fluid. PIF stands for hydrostatic pressure in the interstitial fluid. Okay, so now this hydrostatic pressure, and here it is the colloidal osmotic pressure. This is the 15 millimeters of mercury. Okay, since the colloidal osmotic pressure, it is less compared to here, these molecules will be entering inside the peritubular capillary because of the change in the pressure gradient, and no carrier proteins will be contributing for the entry of substances from the interstitium into the peritubular capillaries. So now we can tell there is a reabsorption of sodium, water and all the other molecules because they have entered the bloodstream. So that was about reabsorption of sodium in the proximal convoluted tubule. Now the fluid, the filtrate has reached the loop of Henle. In the loop of Henle, we have three segments, okay? That is the thin segment, the thin descending, thin ascending and the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. So in thin segment, the sodium chloride, it is passively reabsorbed mainly by the paracellular pathway. And if I have already explained for the PCT, so the same mechanism will be applicable here. You just mention the carrier protein and the mode of transport mechanism, that will be easier. So sodium chloride passively reabsorbed by the paracellular pathway. Then in the thick segment, it is mainly by the sodium hydrogen exchanger. So there will be co-transport, the sodium hydrogen exchanger, which is the carrier protein, which is mainly causing the reabsorption of sodium in the thick segment. And there is also presence of one more protein, that is the co-transport with potassium and chloride. And the name of this carrier protein is very important because this is the site, means this is the site where some of the diuretics, okay, some of the diuretics, which is the treatment modality for hypertension, they are going to block this particular carrier protein, sodium 2-chloride potassium symporter. So the same thing is shown here. So in the thin and the thick segment of the loop of Henle, in the thin segment, as I told, sodium will be passively reabsorbed by the paracellular pathway. That is, it will enter the lateral intercellular space, and this dotted line is representing the passive diffusion. Passive diffusion. Okay, and here you have the active transport mechanism, that is in the thick segment, it is mainly by sodium hydrogen exchanger. Okay, so sodium ions will be entering in exchange for H plus ion. Here again, the H plus ion is getting secreted into the tubular lumen. And now the sodium ions will be thrown out by means of sodium potassium pump, and this chloride, and again one more carrier protein which I have mentioned, is the sodium 2-chloride potassium co-transporter. The function of this carrier protein is to transport one sodium, 2-chloride ions and one potassium ions from the tubular lumen into the epithelial cell. And finally, the chloride ion will diffuse into the interstitium via the chloride channel, sodium by the sodium potassium pump, and potassium, it has a dual effect. Sometimes it will get secreted or sometimes it will get reabsorbed. So this carrier protein is important because, as I told, some of the diuretics, they are called the loop diuretics. That means these diuretics, they mainly act on the loop of Henle. For example, furosemide, then itacrinic acids, these are some of the names of antidiuretic the agents. So these drugs, they mainly act on the loop of Henle, that is the thick segment of loop of Henle, and they block this particular carrier protein, okay, so thereby causing decrease in the reabsorption of sodium. So when the sodium is not reabsorbed, it will be excreted in urine, and that is going to cause decrease in the blood pressure. Now coming to the distal convoluted tubule, it is mainly through a important carrier protein, that is sodium chloride cotransporter. This is mainly responsible for the uptake of one sodium as well as the chloride ion. So both will be taken in by this particular carrier protein, and in the collecting duct it is mainly through a special type of channels called the ENaC channels, that is epithelial sodium channels, and these are mainly responsible for the sodium uptake. Here what I would like to tell is the hormone which is mainly responsible for the reabsorption of sodium is, one is the aldosterone, which is mainly secreted by the adrenal cortex. Okay, so this hormone, it acts on the distal convoluted tubule and it will facilitate the reabsorption of sodium. Another hormone, antidiuretic hormone, which is also called vasopressin, so this acts on the collecting duct as well as the distal tubule and it causes the reabsorption of sodium. So the same thing is diagrammatically represented here. So this is in the early distal tubule, which is mainly by sodium chloride transporter, and here you have in the late distal tubule and the cortical collecting duct, it is mainly by means of ENaC, epithelial sodium channels. Okay, epithelial sodium channels, they are present only in the collecting duct, and these channels, they are mainly blocked by sodium channel blockers, which is again a treatment modality for regulating the blood pressure. Next, the aldosterone, as I told, it mainly acts on the distal tubule and the collecting duct. So this is going to act at this level and the aldosterone antagonist. So they will block the action of aldosterone and they cause the inhibition of reabsorption of sodium ions. And here in the early distal tubule, the sodium chloride cotransporter, this will be inhibited by a special type of diuretics called thiazide diuretics. So these will act on this and they inhibit the transport reabsorption of sodium ions. So that is what I mentioned in the previous slide. Aldosterone mainly acts on the collecting duct via the ENaC channels, epithelial sodium channels, to cause the reabsorption of sodium. And also to some extent, they say cortisol is also playing a role in the reabsorption of sodium from the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting duct. Reabsorption of sodium is also affected by the other ions. For as you have observed in the previous slide, for every sodium reabsorption in the distal convoluted tubule, one potassium, that is K+, will be secreted into the lumen, which competes with H+ ion. Okay, for every one sodium ion reabsorption, it will be competed with potassium and H+ ion. Anything that affect K+ or H+ ion secretion, that can directly affect the sodium reabsorption. What are the other factors which can affect reabsorption of sodium? It depends on the salt intake of an individual. Suppose if there is decreased salt intake, this is going to stimulate the adrenal cortex to secrete the salt retaining hormone, that is the aldosterone. Once the aldosterone is released, it will act on the distal tubule and the collecting duct to cause the reabsorption of sodium. Next, prostaglandin E2, it will inhibit sodium potassium ATPase. That means to tell the sodium potassium pump will not be able to pump the sodium ions that have entered inside the renal tubular epithelial cells to the peritubular capillary. So therefore, the sodium ions will get excreted. So PGE2 will cause decrease in the reabsorption of sodium. Endothelin and other factors like interleukin-1 can stimulate PGE2 and they can inhibit the reabsorption process of sodium. So coming to the regulation of sodium excretion, the tubules reabsorb a constant fraction of the amount filtered rather than a constant amount. So what it means, this sentence means the reabsorption of sodium, it depends on the fraction of sodium ions which is present in the filtered load, but it is not the constant volume of sodium ions which is continuously reabsorbed by the kidney. So it is a fraction, it is not the constant amount. So it depends on the fraction of sodium molecules that is presented to the tubule in the filtered load. And this proportionality is referred to as the glomerulotubular balance. Okay, this is referred to as the glomerulotubular balance. So that was about reabsorption of sodium. Now let us move on to reabsorption of glucose. So as you all are aware, along with the sodium, the glucose, amino acids and bicarbonates are reabsorbed along with the sodium in the early portion of proximal convoluted tubule. And this glucose is a very typical substance among those which will be completely removed from the urine by the secondary active transport mechanism. That means to tell, glucose undergoes 100% reabsorption. No remnants of glucose will be allowed to pass in the urine because it exhibits 100% reabsorption. The glucose will be filtered at the rate of approximately 100 milligram per minute. That is, if the plasma concentration is 80 milligrams per deciliter multiplied by 125. So that will give the filtered load of the glucose molecule. And it is 100% reabsorbed, and no more traces, means no more than a few milligrams, will appear in the urine in a 24 hours sample. Coming to the transport mechanism, which are the carrier proteins that are involved in the reabsorption of glucose? It is mainly co-transporter. That is, this is an example for secondary active transport mechanism, and the name of the carrier protein is sodium glucose co-transporter, which I have already explained along with the sodium. Next, the energy for transport, it is mainly provided by the sodium potassium pump, because this is the one which is causing the driving force for the movement of sodium ions from the tubular lumen into the renal epithelial cells. So the energy is mainly supplied by the sodium potassium pump, and therefore this particular transport mechanism is called secondary active transport mechanism. Now, the glucose will move into the peritubular capillary via the GLUT2. This I have already told. GLUT2 stands for glucose transporter. It is mainly an example for facilitated diffusion or carrier mediated transport mechanism. The same thing is explained here. First, the glucose molecule will bind to the SGLT2, the sodium glucose co-transporter. And along with the sodium, only if both molecules bind to this carrier protein, it will be transported from the lumen into the epithelial cell. Now the glucose is carried into the cell as sodium moves down its electrical and chemical gradient, and the sodium is then pumped out of the cell into the lateral intercellular spaces by the sodium potassium pump. I forgot to mention, the sodium potassium pump, it is not only present on the basal side of the renal tubular epithelial cells, but it is also present on the lateral wall of the tubular epithelial cell. And because of that, only sodium is entering into the lateral intercellular space. Now, glucose is transported by the GLUT2, that is glucose transporter 2, into the interstitial fluid. So that was about the transport of glucose from the tubule into. These are some of the general terminologies, and you have to know what is this renal threshold for glucose, and what is tubular maximum for glucose, and what is renal glycosuria. So what is this renal threshold for glucose? Threshold, you know, for any kind of receptors, they have a threshold. Only when we apply a stimulus of adequate strength, they will respond to it. But here the threshold means it is the concentration of glucose in the blood above which it starts appearing in urine. Okay, so the renal threshold means it is the concentration, the plasma concentration of glucose, that is the glucose concentration in the blood above which it will start appearing in the urine, that is the renal threshold for glucose. The normal renal threshold for glucose is 180 milligram per deciliter. So up to 180 milligram per deciliter, the nephrons have the ability to reabsorb the glucose. If it exceeds more than 180, then the glucose will not be reabsorbed completely, and it will start appearing in the urine, and that is called the renal glycosuria. Then what is this tubular maximum for glucose? It is the maximum capacity of the nephron to reabsorb glucose from the filtered load in an ideal condition. Okay, so the maximum capacity of the nephron, nephron means it is applicable for all that 1.3 millions of nephrons which are present in the kidney. So it is the maximum capacity of all the nephrons to reabsorb glucose from the filtrate in an ideal condition. So ideally, the maximum threshold for the tubule for the reabsorption of glucose, it has to be between the range of 325 to 375 milligram per minute. And this is not seen in reality. That is why they are telling it is in ideal condition. But in reality, it is not 325 to 375 milligram per minute. And it also depends on the sex of an individual. So in case of men, the jubilar maximum is about 375 milligrams per minute. And in case of women, it is about 300 milligrams per minute. Coming to renal glycosuria, it is the inability of the kidney to reabsorb glucose in spite of a normal blood glucose level. So this is the renal glycosuria means here the glucose concentration has not exceeded more than 180 milligram per deciliter. Even though it has not reached the threshold level, but the kidney will fail to reabsorb glucose in spite of normal blood glucose level, then it is called renal glycosuria. This is because, it may be because of reduced tubular maximum for glucose. Okay, so this is mainly because the tubular maximum will itself will get reduced. So this is the graph telling us about the filtered load of the glucose. So here you have the glucose filtered load and the reabsorption or excretion in milligram per minute, and this represents the plasma or glucose concentration. So the normal plasma glucose concentration, it ranges between 80 to 120 milligram percent in the fasting state. And here the 180 is the maximum renal threshold for the nephrons for the reabsorption of glucose. When it crosses, when the threshold exceeds 180 milligram percent, what will happen? It will start appearing in the urine. And here the normal, the 180, if the filtered load, if the plasma concentration is more than 180, then up to 180, the nephrons have the ability to reabsorb the glucose. Suppose if it exceeds, then it will be excreted. So the tubular maximum is about 375 milligrams per minute. Now, as I told, ideally, the transport maximum for glucose is very high, but that is not observed in reality. So, if you plot this, what will happen? So, this is the TMG in an ideal condition. Suppose if this is seen, if all the nephrons have the same capability to reabsorb the same amount of glucose, that means to tell all the nephrons, they have to function all the time to reabsorb the glucose. That is one thing. Second thing, if the nephrons reabsorb the glucose to their maximum level only, then this curve will be observed. So this is considered as the ideal curve, the dotted curve. I know this diagram is bit not clear enough, but this is the only picture which I have got. That is why I put it here. So this is the ideal graph. If all the nephrons, for example, if 150 students are there in the class, and if they listen to the lecture, and if they concentrate, and if they understand, then the result, the outcome will be better. But it will not happen so in reality, isn't it? Maybe some of them, they will be very, very alert, and some of them, they will not concentrate. In the same way, in the kidney also, all the nephrons will not be functioning to their optimal level at all the time. So because of this, the actual curve will deviate from the ideal curve. Okay, so please understand this. The actual curve will deviate from the ideal curve. So here you can see this rounded, the portion of this actual curve. So the gap between the ideal curve and the actual curve is called the splay. Okay, so the gap between the ideal curve and the actual curve is called the splay. So what is this renal splay? So the ideal curve would be obtained if the transport maximum in all the tubules was identical, and if all the glucose were removed from each tubule when the amount filtered was below the transport maximum for glucose. But the actual curve is rounded and deviates considerably from the ideal curve, and this deviation is called splay. The magnitude of the splay is inversely proportional to the avidity with which the transport mechanism binds the substance. Here you just remember, splay is nothing but when you plot the concentration of the glucose against the TMG. So there will be a deviation of the actual curve from the ideal curve, and this deviation is called the splay. So what is the cause for this renal, what is the cause for this splay? Splay may be because all the nephrons, they do not have the same capacity of reabsorption as the ideal nephron. That means to tell all the nephrons, they do not have the same ability to reabsorb the glucose. And second cause for splay is all the nephrons are not active and absorbing to their maximum at any given point of time. So these are the two reasons for the development of splay in the TMG curve. So that was about reabsorption of glucose. Now coming to the reabsorption of water, this is the last one I'll be covering. What is the, so coming to the transport of, that is the tubular handling of water molecules. So if you take the filtered load, the water molecules will be about 180 liters or 180,000 ml per day. In that, 179 liters or 179,000 ml will be reabsorbed, secreted. The water molecules will not be secreted in any part of the nephron, and excreted will be 1 liter per day. It is the normal urinary output. 1 to 2 liters is the normal urinary output, and this again depends on the body needs. It is not constant. Okay, and so therefore the percentage reabsorption of water molecules is about 99.4%. So where does the water reabsorption takes place? It is again in the PCT, proximal convoluted tubule, loop of Henle, DCT and collecting duct. Now coming to the reabsorption of water molecules at the PCT. PCT, it is highly permeable to water. That means the water molecules can easily move in by means of osmosis, and there is passive reabsorption of water along with the osmotic gradient, because as the solutes are moving, they will drag the water molecules along with them, and this is called the passive reabsorption of water. And this is set by the active reabsorption of the solutes, and also the transcellular and paracellular route will be taken by the water molecules to get reabsorbed, and finally they reach the lateral intercellular space and from there to the peritubular space. So the main mechanism involved in PCT, it is mainly by passive reabsorption of water. This is because of active reabsorption of solutes. So what is the solvent drag? This I have already mentioned. So water moving from the lumen to the interstitium through the tight junction carries smaller ions along with it. So this is called the solvent drag. So when the water is moving, or when it is taking the path of lateral cellular or the paracellular pathway, it is carrying the small molecules, small ions along with it, and this is called the solvent drag. So reabsorption of water, it depends. In the loop of Henle, coming to the reabsorption of water in the loop of Henle, here it mainly depends on the length of the loop, because this you will understand in the counter current mechanism. Okay, there you will be studying in detail about how does the length of the loop of Henle is going to affect the concentration of the filtrate. The thin descending limb, it is freely permeable to water. The thin descending limb, it is freely permeable to water, and water will just enter into the cells of the thin descending limb of loop of Henle as if there is no barrier exists. So it is freely permeable. As the tubular fluid flows down into the tubule along the medullary gradient, water will get reabsorbed by the hypotonic peritubular fluid and the tubular fluid. This I'll explain with the diagram. So now, at the beginning, this is the Bowman's capsule, and here the filtration will be taking place. The filtrate will be entering into the Bowman space. It will be entering into the PCT. Look at the osmolarity here. So the osmolarity is 300 milliosmoles. The normal plasma osmolarity is about 298 milliosmoles. Let us round it off to 300 milliosmoles. And therefore, here the filtrate was called ultrafiltrate. It was same as that of the plasma. The tonicity will be 300. And here in the PCT, some of the solutes and the water molecules will be reabsorbed. As the filtrate is descending down or coming down, look at the osmolarity of the filtrate. So here it was 300, but when it enters the thin descending limb of loop of Henle, the water molecules are moving out into the interstitium. So when the water is coming out, the solute concentration will go on increasing. So this is increasing the osmolarity from 300 to 600. Now, at the tip of the loop of Henle, that is the steepest portion of the loop of Henle, which dips into the medulla, the maximum osmolarity observed is 1200, and this is observed only in a juxtamedullary nephron, but not in the cortical nephron. So here 1200 osmolarity will be there. Now as this filtrate with this, now this is called hyperturning because the plasma osmolar, the osmolarity of this filtrate is more than that of the plasma. Now this hypertonic will ascend through the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. What will happen here? This whole segment is impermeable to water. Water neither entering nor coming out. Only thing is the solutes are reabsorbed, the solutes are removed. Again, the osmolarity will start falling, and finally when it reaches the distal tubule, the osmolarity will be 100. And again, because of the influence of other channels, the osmolarity will change from, and by the time it reaches the collecting duct, it will be again 300, and again gradually when it descends down, because of the addition of all these urea and other substances, the final osmolarity of the filtrate will be 1200. So in this diagram, you just concentrate. PCT is freely permeable to water. The thin descending limb of loop of Henle, it is freely permeable to water. And here, it is shown in a solid line. Please make a note, the distal tubule, the distal convoluted tubule, it is the active transport. That means it requires some external stimulus for the reabsorption of water. And this is mainly done by ADH, antidiuretic hormone, acts on the distal tubule and it causes the reabsorption of water molecules. And this much, reabsorption, this is contributing for only 5 to 10% of total water reabsorption. Total water reabsorption. And now, as it descends down, again in the medullary cortical duct, again it is really permeable to water and the water will be coming out. So this is a summary of what I have explained in the diagram. The thin ascending limb is impermeable to water and the thick ascending limb is negligibly permeable to water. And here, because of these transport mechanism, there will be change in the osmolarity of the filtrate and finally the tubular fluid will become hypotonic. So in the DCT and collecting duct, the hypotonic fluid will enter. I think it will be better understood when we start with the counter current mechanism. And if you concentrate on that diagram, you can actually describe, okay? Now that concentrate here, terminal distal collecting duct and the collecting tubule, it is mainly under the influence of action of ADH. So what is this ADH? ADH stands for antidiuretic hormone, and the amount of water reabsorbed will account for only 10 to 12% of water reabsorption. And here it involves the special carrier proteins. They are the water channels, okay? These are called aquaporins, okay? So these aquaporins are, they get activated only under the influence of antidiuretic hormone. So coming to the types of water reabsorption, this is most commonly asked, and different types of water reabsorption. There are two different types of water reabsorption: obligatory reabsorption, facultative reabsorption. Obligatory reabsorption means obligatory, whether the body needs it or not, that much amount of water has to be reabsorbed. And this is going to take place at the level of PCT, proximal convoluted tubule. So the passive reabsorption of water in PCT, secondary to active reabsorption of solutes, is the obligatory reabsorption. As I told, it is not depending on the needs of the body. That much amount of water will always be reabsorbed at the PCT. It is contributing for 60% of total reabsorption. Coming to the facultative reabsorption of water molecules. So here, the reabsorption of water that is in the distal tubule and the collecting duct under the influence of ADH, antidiuretic hormone. Only if the antidiuretic hormone is released and if it acts on the distal tubule and the collecting duct, then only that the last 5 to 10% of water reabsorption will be taking place. And this varies according to the need of the body, and therefore it is called facultative reabsorption. So please try to remember these two types of water reabsorption, obligatory and facultative. So what is this obligatory volume of urine? So excess ADH, a small volume of concentration of urine will be formed. That is, ADH is antidiuretic hormone. Suppose if antidiuretic hormone is produced in a larger concentration, it is anti. That means it is causing the less urine to be passed. So it will lead to smaller volume of urine to be passed. It cannot be less than 500 ml to avoid accumulation of metabolic waste products. at any given point of time, the urine output has to be more than 500 ml. And this is called the obligatory volume of urine. That means the minimal amount of urine which is sufficient to cause the excretion of metabolic waste products is the obligatory urine volume. It should never be less than 500 ml. So role of hormones aldosterone and ADH, they play a very important role in the reabsorption of water. So these two are mainly also responsible for the reabsorption of sodium. So whenever the hormone is trying to increase the reabsorption of sodium, the water molecules will also be transported, or the water molecules will also be reabsorbed. So these two hormones, they play a major role in the reabsorption of water, and both of them, they act on the DCT and also in the collecting duct. So coming to the aldosterone, it is mainly a salt retaining hormone. It causes the water molecules to go along with it. ADH is the vasopressin. Vasopressin, it is mainly stored in the posterior pituitary, and this vasopressin, it mainly acts via V2 receptors, which is present on the epithelial cells in the collecting duct. And when it binds with the V2 receptors, these aquaporins, they normally present in the renal tubular epithelial cells in the collecting duct. So only when vasopressin binds to V2 receptors, it causes the mobilization of these aquaporins, and these aquaporins will be mobilized from the cytoplasm to the membrane, and they get incorporated into the cell membrane, and they facilitate the movement of water molecules into the epithelial cells. Therefore, the aquaporins are called the water channel proteins. So there are different types of aquaporins. We have aquaporin 1, 2, 3, 4, depending on the site. So these are aquaporin 1, it is mainly present in the PCT, and it is causing the movement of water molecules. Now, that is movement, it is causing the reabsorption of water molecules in the PCT. And aquaporin 2, it is mainly present in the collecting tubule and the outer medullary collecting duct in the inner medullary. Just remember, collecting tubule and the collecting duct, the aquaporin 2 is present. Aquaporin 3, it is mainly the medullary collecting duct. But the function, if you look at the function, the main function of all the aquaporins is the water reabsorption. Aquaporin 4, it is present in the medullary collecting duct. Coming to the applied aspects, so what is this osmotic diuresis? So whenever the solute concentration is getting increased, that means if the solutes are not getting reabsorbed in the body, for example, in diabetes mellitus, what will happen? There will be increase in the plasma glucose concentration, the glucose concentration will be more than the renal threshold. Therefore, it will start appearing in the urine. So this will facilitate the more water molecules to move along with it. So this is called the osmotic diuresis, which is mainly observed in diabetes mellitus. So what is diabetes insipidus? So diabetes insipidus, it is mainly because of the deficiency of hormone, antidiuretic hormone. So the main function of antidiuretic hormone is to cause the reabsorption of water. But if it is absent, it will cause increased frequency of micturition. So the person will be voiding large volume of diluted urine because it will not have sufficient amount of solute load in him. So this is called diabetes insipidus. The last slide, what is this water intoxication? So whenever we consume more amount of water, sometimes these days we have a habit, water is good for health, someone tells, and we go on consuming or we go on drinking lots of water. So the main disadvantage seen with the more ingestion of water molecules means it will dilute the extracellular fluid compartment, and so it will become more hypotonic because the amount of the concentration of the solutes present in the ECF in relation to the volume of water will be reduced. So it will become hypotonic. So you have done the experiment also, where you have studied the effect of hypotonic saline on RBCs. So what will happen? The RBCs will start swelling up because of endosmosis. So all the cells in the body will swell up. And this is going to affect mainly the brain cells, and it can lead to convulsions, coma, and death. And it also occurs when there is imbalance between the water intake and the output. So all these transport mechanisms, and this tubular reabsorption, it is mainly trying to maintain the homeostasis. It is trying to, for example, if you take tubular reabsorption of sodium, it will mainly trying to maintain the normal plasma concentration of the sodium the normal plasma concentration of the glucose and the normal concentration of the water, because there is an input and there is an output. Finally, there has to be a balance between input and the output. I hope you have understood the topic, at least you have understood the concept. So please read about this topic. So this is very important. It covers lot many examination questions, and this is the basis for your countercurrent mechanism. Thank you. Thanks. Sorry, Bhatta. Huh? Bhatta. Yeah, thanks.